Frizzle Fighters. We've read The Witch King by Martha Wells, the newest, hottest release of the fantasy genre, and it was bad.
It was certainly something.
I think my first impression of it was like, we were listening to the audiobook, and the narrator's accent is very thickly British, and then there were all these new fantasy words, and it was like, I couldn't tell what anything they were saying.
It was really hard to understand them. But I was so excited for this book when we first started, and that quickly became not the case.
So this book, it's got like a really nice premise. It depends on what you define as the premise. Anyway, but the opening is like so strong. That opening chapter, I was hooked. So what it is you open up and there's like these kind of sketchy adventurers going into a tomb of like this ancient evil that they've heard prophecies that they can like resurrect and become, harness the power of this ancient evil. And then that ancient evil quickly kills them all. And that's our narrator.
Yeah, it turns out the ancient evil is the POV character.
Yeah.
Main character of the book.
And it's so good because he wakes up and he's like, ugh, my enemies trapped me in this tomb. I've probably been asleep for like maybe even a whole year. Like, this is so lame. I gotta go find my friends. They're probably worried about me. And then
one of the people who like came with the bad guys is like, wait a second. You're the guy who's been sealed in here. I've heard all of the legends about you.
So we were thinking, surely he's been trapped for like minimum 200 years, probably closer to 1,000, yeah. Right? There are legends about him. There was this one moment where he's like looking around at the tomb and he's like, ah, this is so old. They must have not built it for me. They must have repurposed some other old ruin that they found. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, honey, you're in denial.
Yeah.
And then...
turns out that he really has just been in there for a year.
It was so disappointing because the premise is so intriguing to have like this man out of time. And then he just runs into like one of his friends and they're just like magically chatting and they're like, oh, what have you been up to for the past year? We've missed you. Did you disappear out for some reason? And it's like, what? It's so disappointing. It's so disappointing after such a strong beginning. And then it turns out he's only really been gone a year. And it's like, what was the point of having him be captured at all?
Mm-hmm.
Just without that. And yeah. Nothing would have changed.
It would have taken out my favorite part.
I guess that would have changed. You would have had better expectations for the rest of the book.
True.
So another thing that this book really fails to deliver on its promise to the reader is the title itself, Witch King. It turns out our protagonist is not a king or really a witch.
Nope.
Definitely not the king of the witches because they don't have any political structure. It's just a nickname that someone gave him at some point. Do the witches even like follow his bidding or anything? Not really.
No, not at all, actually.
It's just like a weird nickname that doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, it's not even really that relevant.
People don't even really call him at all.
It never really comes up. Makes him sound all like super powerful, and I mean, I guess he is.
We'll talk about that later, because that's a different problem. But like, it's so weird that this book is named The Witch King, and then, no, there is no Witch King. In fact, that's not what the book is about in any way.
Yeah, him being a witch isn't even really that relevant either.
He could just take away all of his witch powers and like nothing about the plot would change.
You could probably take away all of his powers and the plot wouldn't change.
Well, it'd be less like killing.
Yeah.
But yeah, I guess. So what's this book really about then? We have two timelines. We have the present timeline, which is where he wakes up in the tomb. He's only been gone a year. And he's like, oh no, when I was imprisoned, also one of my buddies, Taryn, was kidnapped. So the entire present timeline is him trying to find his friend, Taryn.
That's the whole book.
That's the whole book. He goes from place to place and he's like, hey, have you guys seen Taryn? And they're like, no, and also we hate you. And then they just keep getting new mini quests that is like, ah, okay, we don't know where Taryn is, but we know where someone else is who knows where a location stone is that will help you track her down.
It's just fetch quest after fetch
quest. It's just fetch quest after fetch quest in the present timeline. It's so boring.
It never goes anywhere.
We were there at like 90% done with this book. And I saw that it was 90% done. And I turned to him and I was like, we're 90% done with this book? Like, because it didn't feel like it had gone anywhere.
Nothing had happened
for like the entire book.
Nothing had happened.
And it was like, wait, there's no plot to this book, is there? Like,
there
the past timeline has some more plot.
Yeah, was my favorite part of the book.
Yeah, I think the past timeline is definitely better. If this book had just taken out its entire present timeline and only been past timeline, it would have
been better.
So much better. Anyway, so the past timeline is him when he's a baby demon. By the way, our narrator's a demon, and he possesses the bodies of dead people. So it's about him starting out as like a baby baby demon possessing his first human and, like, making friends. The army comes through and kills all of his friends, and then he's imprisoned for a while. And then some people go to let him out, and they're like, hey, can you help us out with our revolution we're doing right here? And he's like, oh, okay, I guess.
It's more interesting than the present
timeline. Much more interesting than the present timeline. There are things happening in the past timeline.
Still... not great.
Oh, it's still not great because it's either there's not much happening when he's just like a baby demon having friends, and then suddenly he's just like going along with other people's revolution, but he's not really like being proactive or having his own goals. He's just like, well, these people are fighting against the people who put me in prison for a while, so yeah, I'll join that.
Yeah, it's, the past is a lot of things happening to him and not a lot of him doing things.
Yeah, but at least there's things happening.
But there were things happening.
So it's much better than the present timeline. And then I think the worst part of this book was the end. So in the present timeline, another thing he's trying to figure out is who put him in this tomb. You know, he was in prison for a whole year, guys. It's a big deal. So he finally figures out it was one of his, like, politics friends? Not the same as in the past timeline, because it's, like, hundreds of years later. And they did it because they were worried that he would bring down the empire that they were the head of. And then in the confrontation, he's like, well, joke's on you. Actually, 5 years ago, I put in a plan in motion that's already bringing down your empire as we speak. So you didn't have to kill me because...
it's already done.
It's already done. And
you're too late.
And it was like, wait, he cared about the empire?
Remember the other side plot of the book? Turns out it happened 5 years ago.
And
you weren't interested in that, I hope.
It was so confusing because there's so many, like, just politics terms thrown out through the entire book, and they never really explain, like, what the political situation is. There's, like, a few lines where he, like, complains about how he doesn't like that the politics is slowly transforming more and more empire-like, but, like, I never got the vibe throughout the book that he, like, cared enough to do anything about it or was involved in politics at all. So to have the big reveal at the end of the book be like, actually, I care a lot about politics and I already took down your empire. It's just a really slow takedown. You'll notice eventually. Like, what?
Yeah, if you wanted to read a book about the Dark Lord reclaiming his power, this is not that book. But if you want to read a book about how political systems slowly change over time...
it's also not that book!
It's also not that book.
But it's so weird that at the end of the book, like, it's trying to be a book about, see, in the past timeline, started the revolution, which started the beginnings of this empire that now in the present timeline, hundreds of years later, is a problem that he's taking down. Which also would have been such a fascinating book to have, like, the contrast of, like, setting up the empire and then later realizing, okay, wait, we don't actually want this.
Unfortunately, this also isn't that
book. This isn't that book at all. It was so funny to me reading through, like, the reviews on Goodreads of this book, because so many people are, like, trying to give a little summary of what the book's about, as you do when you're book reviewing. And some of them are talking about, like, him being imprisoned, and some of them are talking about the politics things. Neither of those are what the book actually ends up being about. That's just what the beginning and the very end are kind of hinting that the book might have been about in an alternate dimension.
Honestly, I still don't really know what the book is about.
It's so confusing. Here is what I was pondering a lot about, is how could we improve this book? I think one of the ways is to make the time jump, like, actually be 1,000 years.
Just all of the time jumps should be bigger.
Because a year time jump, it's so useless. It makes the premise feel so cheap. Gross, honestly. And if the time jump was actually 1,000 years, then you could really... like, explore more the world used to be this way, and this was a good political system, and now I see what I've set up has changed. So you could really delve into that better, I think, because he wouldn't have seen every single step and, like, not done anything along every single step of the way, which he was a present for. I think also it would have created better character development for him in the present timeline. Because in the past timeline, he's starting to, like, make new friends, and he's, like, really kind of scared and traumatized because he was in prison for a while, and then he started to make friends with these revolutionaries, and that's a nice timeline. Like, I liked that plot of him slowly coming back out of his shell. And then we could also have him, if he's been in prison for 1,000 years, well, all of his friends are dead now. We won't have that stupid quest of him trying to find his friend who was also in prison. Like, done. Cut it out. No more. Instead, we can have a plot about him making new friends. But now, his problem isn't that he's, like, kind of in his shell and shy and, like, doesn't know how human interaction works because he's still kind of a baby demon. Now, he's incredibly paranoid. He's incredibly angry because he was betrayed 1,000 years ago and imprisoned, and now, like, what the heck? You know, I'm never making friends again. And that would have been such a stronger internal conflict.
It would have been.
Compared to the current present timeline, which has no internal conflict. That would have been so much cooler.
Plus, it would, like, fulfill more the Dark Lord who was sealed away and would be problems if he got out aspect of the plot. Because that also never happened.
No, it really didn't.
I think another thing that could be done to make the book better is just cut out, like, maybe half of the characters.
At a minimum. Like, I think you could cut out probably two-thirds of the side characters. So much better. Especially with the fetch quest. Mm-hmm. Every single time we went to a new location, you'd pick up, like, two more sidekicks. And then they never did anything.
No, and their names were so complicated that it was impossible to keep any of them straight by the end of the book.
And it's like, okay, now we're going out with our group of, how many now? 11 sidekicks?
How many of them are relevant? Still only two.
It's a thing that I've actually seen with Martha Wells' other books, The Murderbot Diaries. I love those books. They're like my obsession. Every single one of them 5 stars, right?
Yeah.
But one of their failings is too many side characters. It's the same thing as here, where you get introduced to a bunch and then lots of them don't end up becoming relevant. So it's just like a bunch of extra names that you have to remember, because at least in that series, they don't switch that much from book to book. So you have a few more books to get to know everyone. In this one, I don't know if there's a sequel or not. I tried to look into it and I couldn't find word either way. They kind of left it open enough that there could be. I kind of hope there isn't.
Yeah, I don't think it was good enough.
No. So another thing that was super confusing about this book is there are like 3 different magics.
Yeah, there's
at a
minimum. There's the demon magic, the witch magic, and the
expositor
magic,
which is kind of like their wizards. So the demon magic is our main character can suck the life force from people. The witch magic is
unclear.
Some people commune with nature spirits and use them to do their bidding. And some people draw like runes and do other types of spells. Then the expositor magic is you harness pain and then can do things with it.
Yeah.
Pretty much unlimited, it seems like.
Depending on how much pain you have.
So for our protagonist, who is an immortal demon, who can just like keep stabbing himself, he's got kind
he's
of
got
an unlimited supply of pain. So he
can kind of do whatever he wants.
So that's one of the problems with our protagonist is he has all 3 of the magics. And he's really good at all 3 of the magics. And then that means that there's never a situation where he's like in jeopardy or really in danger, especially in the present timeline, because he can just like pull out a magic spell for anything.
Yeah, there were all sorts of situations where for one reason or another, one magic system wouldn't work. It never really explained why, but one magic system wouldn't work. And then he could just rely on either of the other two to do it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So it tried to make it a conflict, but it just never really felt like one.
Yeah, like there's this one limitation, at least with the demon magic, I think also with the witch magic, it was confusing, where he couldn't do it in water. And then there was a moment where he had to like work underwater. I'm like, oh, we're finally gonna have like some real stakes here. And he's like, oh, it's okay. I got my 3rd magic. It'll work. It's like, we don't, you didn't need another one. He's just so overpowered to like the definition of, okay, now there's no conflict in the plot because you always know he's gonna win every fight. And even if he doesn't win, he's also immortal and indestructible. So it doesn't even matter if he loses. And the magic is just so poorly explained. It was really funny reading through all the Goodreads reviews and seeing different reviewers try to explain the magic. And they were always like contradicting each other.
Completely.
And then also contradicting what I thought magic was like. So I don't know who's right. I don't even think that fact matters. The fact is that no one knows. No one is sure. Everyone thinks they understand, but everyone has contradictory opinions, and like, it really subtracted from the plot.
Yeah, it was too confusing.
Yeah.
I enjoy pretty complicated magic systems. This one was too much. Too little explanation for not enough payoff.
Yeah. They could have taken out either like the witch magic or the expositor magic.
Or
and,
honestly,
like,
probably even both.
They could have just taken out both, and like, it would have been totally fine, the same. I think another thing that this book really failed to explain was the politics of it all.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we already talked about how like, it didn't explain throughout the entire book that he was anti-empire or like wanted to do something about it or like even what the empire was or doing poorly or like anything. You know, I was gonna make another point, but that actually just summarizes the point.
Yeah.
It's just that the book doesn't care to explain to us the information that we need in order to care about the book.
Yeah, it ends up being just a whole jumbled mess of things that you don't understand and you hope the characters understand.
They annoyingly do at some points. Annoying. The entire book was just kind of annoying. I do want to say the pros of this book, because we've complained so much, and there is so much to complain about, but I do think that our main character is incredibly likable.
Yeah, he was great.
And charismatic, and has some interesting thoughts and feelings sometimes, especially in the past timeline.
Mm-hmm.
So he was a joy to follow. Like, every time he had, like, a triumph or a failure, like, I was cheering for him.
Yeah, he also has quite a few retorts that were pretty funny. Quite an enjoyable POV character.
Yeah, I think if he was boring, I wouldn't have bothered finishing this book. No way, Jose. But the fact that our protagonist isn't boring made up for all of that.
I also really liked the other side main character. I don't remember her name.
𝐋𐈎.
She was cool too. They'd been friends for like a really long time.
Like hundreds of years, because they're both immortals.
So their whole dynamic was just really fun to read.
In terms of the character relationships and the character entertainment value, that's where this book excels. Character development, nope. Tension, arcs, conflict, not as much, but there is that saving grace. Mm-hmm. Kai, our protagonist, really straddles the line really well between someone who's like kind of scary violent sometimes and like someone who's really likable. So even when he's doing things like eating people's life force, it's like, yeah, you do that. Like, it's entertaining and fun.
Yeah, the whole first chapter was so good.
So just recommend chapter one.
Yeah. You don't necessarily need to read more than that.
So overall, what would you rate this book?
I would probably give it maybe 2 stars.
Respect that. I think I'd give it 3 stars. Because I was entertained enough by the protagonist to make it all the way through. It was okay.
Yeah, I just don't do super well with audiobooks.
Yeah, we were also listening to the audiobook as we were taking a road trip, and that also made it harder. And I think its book tone is Celadon Green, which means it's a book that is character and atmosphere focused and intellectual. Yeah, you really need to love the intellectual world building aspects to enjoy this book.
That's like the only part of the book.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you for watching.